You are here in our homes with us, but you are everywhere. We too often forget your nearness. Remind us this morning, God, and bind us together so that we may be physically separate, yet still mystically joined together as your body. Amen. Please join us at home, if you can, singing hymn 132, verses 2 and 3, Good Christian Friends Rejoice. There is no end to the mercies of our Heavenly Father. See His arms open wide for you. Run into His loving embrace. Trust that you are safe with Him. Know that you are forgiven and earnestly welcomed again into your place in the family of God.
Thank you.
chapter 4, verses 14 through 21. Jesus returned to Galilee with the power of the Spirit. News about him spread everywhere. He taught in the Jewish meeting places, and everyone praised him. Jesus went back to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and as usual, he went to the meeting place on the Sabbath. When he stood up to read from the scriptures, he was given the book of Isaiah the prophet. He opened it and read, "The Lord's Spirit has come to me, because he has chosen me to tell the good news to the poor. The Lord has sent me to announce freedom for prisoners, to give sight to the blind, to free everyone who suffers, and to say, 'This is the year the Lord has chosen.'" Jesus closed the book, then handed it back to the man in charge and sat down. Even in the meeting place, everyone in the meeting place looked straight at Jesus. Then Jesus said to them, "What you have just heard has come true today." It is a new year. The arrival of 2021 has been eagerly anticipated by many. Indeed, we have reason to celebrate this first Sunday of the year. Highly effective COVID-19 vaccines have been developed and are being administered to healthcare workers across the country and the globe. Hopefully, other at-risk groups will be vaccinated soon. An end to the pandemic is in sight. Although the COVID-19 pandemic was perhaps the most difficult aspect of 2020 for most of us, it was not the only source of pain. The killings of Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, and George Floyd, as well as the disproportionate toll COVID-19 has taken on Indigenous, Black, and Latino communities, have served as devastating reminders that we have yet to expunge the sinful stain of racism from our hearts and the fabric of our communities and our country. But what to do about this? Most everyone agrees that racism is wrong. We just can't seem to find our way beyond it. Racism in America sometimes feels like the very definition of recalcitrant. A vaccine against it sure would be nice, but no such silver bullet exists. Stuck between a rock, racism is unacceptable. In a hard place, we can't seem to get rid of it. It's tempting to throw our hands up, to declare the problem is not ours, or does not even exist. God, of course, offers us no such way out. Instead, our Lord commands us throughout Scripture, and in no uncertain terms, to seek the truth, repent of our partialities, and set the oppressed free. There has always been an incongruency between the actions of Christians and the actions of Christ. One of the most painful discrepancies between the heart of God and the revealed heart of much of His church has been the Christian support of white supremacy. When we think of white supremacists, we tend to think of Ku Klux Klan members or Nazi skinheads. White supremacy, however, is more than these things. It is the belief that white people and white culture are superior to non-white people and non-white cultures. People who hold these beliefs and accordingly carry out racist actions, however subtle or culturally acceptable, have most often been well-mannered Christians. These Christians were the architects of our nation, our ancestors, and at times even us. The vision of white superiority that has shaped destructive American policy over the past 400 years was not simply allowed by complacent white Christians. It was in part invented and sustained by the white church. We all have a deep psychological need to be right, to feel like a good person. God has written His law in our hearts, so we feel badly when we're doing something that is against His will. When we do not want to stop committing the sin Christ is calling us away from, we construct excuses and theologies that allow us to feel like a good person while still doing a bad thing. White Americans needed the land they were taking from the indigenous inhabitants of America. White Americans needed the free labor of enslaved Africans to build up the economy of the fledgling colonies and then sustain the economy of the new country. At the same time, white Americans also needed to feel good and not bad about themselves. A Christian theology, which had been constructed in Europe to justify colonialization and the African slave trade, was imported to America and embraced by many, if not most, white Americans. It is painful to look back through our nation and our faith's history and note the codependency between white supremacy and Christianity. We cannot move forward, however, without a decent understanding of our past, warts and all. White supremacy was the bedrock of American slavery. Black people were considered less human than white people, and so enslaving them was taught to be God's will. This quote from Jefferson Davis illustrates the dominant theological opinion of slavery in the antebellum South. He said, "My own convictions as to the Negro slavery, as to Negro slavery, are strong. We recognize the Negro as God and God's book and God's law and nature tell us to recognize him, are inferior, fitted expressly for servitude. You cannot transform the Negro into anything one-tenth as useful or as good as what slavery enables them to be." Genocidal actions against indigenous Americans enabled European migrants to acquire the land necessary to create the United States of America. The abominations carried out against the first people of the Americas were also premised on the conviction that white people were superior to non-white people. The genocide, in which white Christian settlers are estimated to have killed 56 million indigenous Americans throughout South, Central, and North America, was justified by arguments of divine providence. William Bradford, governor of the Plymouth Colony, wrote in 1633, commenting on the gruesome death of neighboring Native Americans from smallpox, quote, "For it pleased God to visit these Indians with a great sickness, and such a mortality that of 1,000, above 900 and half of them died, and many of them did rot above ground for want of burial." In 2011, just 10 years ago, Brian Fisher, the director of issue analysis for government and public policy at the American Family Association, a Christian organization, wrote of indigenous Americans, quote, "The superstition, savagery, and sexual immorality of Native Americans left them morally disqualified from sovereign control of American soil, which is now properly the possession of Euro-Americans by right of conquest." The belief that white people and culture are inherently more valuable than non-white people and cultures also formed the foundation of Jim Crow-era segregation and racial terror. Again, the will and character of our true one God was grossly misrepresented in the false idol that segregation was created in the true God's place was used to sanctify destructive beliefs and behaviors. Over 4,000 black people were lynched in the United States in the 7 years following the Civil War. Their murderers were mobs of white Christians, sometimes still dressed in their Sunday best, having just come from worship. Lynchings of black men and women were often described as having the aura of a religious service, as white mob members shouted out epitaphs such as, "Glory to God," while watching a fellow image bearer being tortured to death. Racial segregation was defended ardently by appeals to God's design for the races. As recently as the year 2000, the Christian University, Bob Jones University, in South Carolina, did not permit interracial dating of its students. Bob Jones Sr., the university's founding president, advised, "White folks and colored folks, you listen to me. You cannot run over God's plan and God's established order without having trouble. God never meant to have one race. It was not his purpose at all. God has a purpose for each race." In the late 19th century and early to mid 20th century, indigenous American children were forcibly removed from their families and detained in church-run boarding schools. The schools were very often abusive. The intent of the system was stated by Brigadier General Richard Henry Pratt, who was the founder and superintendent of Carlisle Indian Industrial School. He famously and often stated that schools must kill the Indian to save the man. Presbyterians, Catholics, Methodist, Episcopalians, Congregationalists, Orthodox, Baptist, Reformed Dutch, and Lutherans all ran these schools, all perpetuated and benefited from this white supremacist system. We would all like to believe that racist behaviors and ideologies cease to exist in American Christians after the passage of the Voting Rights Act in 1965 and the closing of the Last Native American Residential School in 1972. That is not true, however. Attitudes so deeply entrenched have been painfully hard to extricate. Our country is still struggling to heal the gaping wounds inflicted on us all by our legacy of white supremacy. In 2018, the average black worker made just 67% of what the average white worker made. White Americans have 17 times more accumulated wealth than black Americans. Black Americans are twice as likely as white Americans to lack health insurance. Black Americans make up 12% of the U.S. population, but 32% of the prison population. Black, Latino, and Indigenous Americans are more than two times as likely to die of COVID-19 than white Americans. Black women are almost three times as likely to die in childbirth than white women. Hate crimes have been increasing steadily over the past 6 years, with a record 51 hate crime deaths in 2019. More than 5,400 Latino minor children were separated from their parents between 2017 and 2018 as a result of the U.S.'s zero-tolerance immigration policy. Over 500 of these children are still waiting to be reunited with their families. The separating of migrant children from their parents was justified using appeals to Romans 13 by government officials. The legacy of racism in our country, our community, and our hearts is more than the sum total of a lot of depressing and scary statistics, however. It is real harm being caused to real people. The heritage of white supremacy, our current pervasive racial inequalities, may seem to be primarily the problem of those black, indigenous, and Latino folks who are less likely to accumulate wealth, more likely to be imprisoned, more likely to perish of COVID-19, etc., but it is not. Ultimately, the worst damage inflicted by racism is the damage it inflicts on the soul. Yes, enslaved, lynched, and segregated African Americans were treated as less than human and suffered horribly. The misery felt by Indigenous Americans as they endured a physical and cultural genocide cannot be comprehended by those of us who did not experience the Trail of Tears or residential schools. The people who were truly disfigured, however, were the slave traders and slave masters. The settlers who collected a bounty for every Native American scalp they delivered to colonial and then state governments. Jesus teaches us that the enemy cannot destroy our body, but can destroy our soul. Racism hurts the bodies of those that oppress us, but the souls of those who benefit from it. We all need freedom from the enduring cords of anti-Black, anti-Indigenous, and anti-Latino racism that bind us. If the country is ever going to finally move into a new day of racial justice, the American church must lead the way. It is the church that developed the heretical theology that justified white supremacy and continues to justify aspects of structural racism today. The needle simply won't move if us Christians do not partner with God to move it. God is always doing a new thing. He knows how to smash the stronghold of racism. He longs for us to put our hearts, minds, and hands to the task. Maybe you're thinking right now, I didn't steal any land from the Native Americans. My ancestors didn't even own slaves. I don't see how any of this is my fault. Discussions about racism can be so difficult, and the problem feels so overwhelming that they often trigger these types of thoughts and emotions. I've struggled with them myself. In response to these feelings, I want to say a couple things. One, defensive feelings are natural. They can obstruct us from doing God's will, however. If we say everything is fine when it is not fine, so that we can continue to feel good about ourselves and our society, then we are refusing to partner with God in building his very good kingdom. We are allowing our pride to tie our hands together. When I have feelings of defensiveness around racism or anything else, I try to lay those feelings at the feet of Jesus. He knows I'm a sinner, and he saves me. We don't need to prove to ourselves or anyone else that we are good people when we have Jesus Christ as our Savior. Second, if you're white and our congregation is 100% white, our denomination 92% white, you're benefiting from a legacy of white supremacy, even if you do not want to, even if you did not lay any of the bricks for yourself. Most importantly, it doesn't really matter how much of the blame each of us and our ancestors are specifically responsible for. We are Christians. We have been given the ministry of reconciliation by our Master Jesus Christ, who was wholly sinless, and yet poured out his entire life to save us who are sinners. He proclaimed the start of his ministry by announcing that the oppressed will be set free. As his followers, we must labor for freedom for the oppressed as well. Our vocation as Christians demands that we pour ourselves out for others in the manner of Jesus Christ, without stopping to dissect first how much of the suffering can or cannot be blamed on us. Well, what kind of New Year's sermon has this been? A depressing trudge through the history of Christian white supremacy in America doesn't seem like an uplifting way to kick off 2021. Absolutely. The darkness of racism can be overwhelming, and it's certainly hard to talk about. The light of Christ always shines in the darkness, however. Bad news never has the last word. Always there is good news. God is never without a witness. He is calling us this morning to be that witness. He is calling us today to be repairers of the breach. White Christians have caused great harm to our black and brown brothers and sisters, but that doesn't have to be the end of the story. God's dream of racial reconciliation is possible. Right now, Christians across the country are responding to the nudgings of the Holy Spirit and are working to create more racially just congregations and communities. The Presbyterian Church USA has deeply committed our denomination to anti-racism work over the past few years. In 2020, our congregation became a Matthew 25 church. One of the core focuses of the Matthew 25 initiative is the call to work towards dismantling structural racism. On this first Sunday of the new year, the Matthew 25 committee is excited to announce that our church family will embark on a year of equality over the course of the next 12 months. It's an aspirational title. We know that we have a long way to go before equality is achieved in our congregation, our workplaces, our community, and our country. The only way to get to biblical equality, however, is to just put one foot in front of the other in pursuit of this holy goal. Throughout 2021, we will learn together about the history of racism and its contemporary manifestations. We will imagine together what a more racially just future could look like. We will discern steps we can all take to get to that longed-for future. A future where reconciliation, justice, equality, and true peace have been achieved. A future thoroughly ruled by the law of love. God has already granted a vision of this glorious day to us. Hear him speaking through the book of Revelation. After this, I saw a vast crowd, too great to count, from every nation and tribe and people and language, standing in front of the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes and held palm branches in their hands, and they were shouting with a great roar, "Salvation comes from our God, who sits on the throne and from the Lamb." May the Spirit guide us and empower us. May the Lord bless us as we journey towards this vision of racial equality together. Amen. All right, we're going to be singing hymn 749. It's different from the one that's written, so we'll listen to Peggy and Elaine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. If you have any prayer concerns, you please contact Pastor Scott. Lift them up right now. I don't have anything specific that I've heard that I need to pray for the church family. So please join me in praying right now. Lord, we thank you that you are here with us. Lord, we thank you for this new day. We thank you that you never give up on us. We thank you for your goodness and your glorious, wonderful kingdom. Lord, we pray today specifically for people who are feeling lonely, for people who are feeling scared. We pray for an end to this pandemic. We pray for the swift distribution of these vaccines, Lord, and we praise you for the development of them. God, please help us to be more like you each and every day. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Please join me in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We thank you for your continued support of the church. If you would like to send a donation, you can send it to the address you have here, PO Box 444, Redwood Falls. Please join us for the offertory prayer. Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer of our lives, all that we have is yours. Please use these tithes and offerings that we are now returning to you to build up your just, peaceable, abundant, and everlasting kingdom. Amen.